Okay, guys, I'm really sorry. I have tried three times to do this recording and I have failed miserably in getting it done. But at any rate, here we go. The first assignment for week five. I did a lot of demos for this. Most of you came to at least one of them, so it should give you a pretty good idea of what to do. So the first one up is Spencer. And the biggest issue I have is with your figure. You're using the gray paper, which is great, but looking at your reference, you have to squint your eyes, and you can see that there's just this one area of light. It's a good reference, but your drawing doesn't represent the reference. One of the reasons we use the toned paper is so that we don't have to do these outlines. So I went in with Photoshop here real quick and added some dark. It's easy to just fill this in, and then you can play with the opacity. So it's a cool way to do like a little mock-up. But putting in some dark in here, and then even more dark, and then a bit of light, and then even more light, and trying to show that you squint now at the quote unquote drawing, you'll get something more close to what is on the actual figure reference. So would even go so far as to paint in this a bit darker, not that color dark obviously, but be like at 50% more dark on here. And that kind of brings that down closer to, there's something in here too. You could even do like you would work this up as a gradient up here, and that's going to give you a better solution than this is. So that's the number one thing regarding your figure. And if we move on to your next image, you've got fish. So I see a roundness and light and dark, and if you look closely at your reference, you'll see that the texture itself will disappear in the highlighted areas and in the very dark areas, and only really shows up in the places in between. So your fish here actually has consistent amount of texture across the surface. We could add in to be a bit darker down in here and to lighten up those the intensity of the texture so that it is less show it doesn't show up hardly at all. If you look here, you can see no texture here, no texture, just a tiny little spattering of texture here, no texture here. Most of the texture comes in here in between the highlights and the shadows. Then finally, with your fabric, the worst thing in the world is to do a terry cloth towel. But even with this, and it looks like you did draw it from your own reference, which is a good thing. Your actual drawing ends up being an outline without a lot of, there's a little bit of value across the surface of it, but the hard lines that you've got outlining it and contouring it serves to flatten it significantly. If you look at your reference, you can see that it's got it's darker on the right than it is on the left, and the background is darker than the fabric itself. More of an oblique angle on the light gives you a better indication of the structure, but this is not, these are not lines, these are just shadowed areas of these horizontal indentations, lights and shadows. So that's where you need to play up the switch of value. I would love to see you at least take the chiaroscuro drawing to a higher level of finish. You don't even need to detail out the face, etc. Just looking for development of the lights and the darks in the proper way. All right, so that's this. And next one up, we have Liliana. Indiana. You are. I had everything all set up here. Now I've got it all screwed up. Here we go. I was playing around with your drapery a little bit. And I have your reference right here. So this is pretty good reference, except you need a stronger light on your drawing. It would be, you'd get a lot more variety and value of your, if you do it with a stronger light. So I took your actual drawing here and started playing with the textures of it, kind of soften it up, improve the contrast. I don't know if your paper is actually this gray or if it's white paper that you've put, you've been working on, but I would definitely go in and add in a little bit of a little more highlight here to bring up blending out a little bit more of this highlight to make it stand out even more. Try to get rid of the line. Try to develop. Go back to your reference here. If you can set this back up, that would be awesome. If you can't, now that's okay too. You did draw from an actual piece of cloth, so it's a good thing, but I would really like to see you develop your range of values more intently. It will look a lot more realistic if you can bring out that light, especially. See here, this is light right here and this right here. So often you can squint at your setup and then squint at your drawing and see if you're matching the quality of the shadows and the highlights to give it as much sense of depth as what you're actually seeing. So once you start to learn how to do this by observation, then you can make this up, and that's what's really cool about drawing from actual things. You're not interpreting someone else's interpretation, but you're interpreting it for yourself and learning how to create that structure for yourself. And you can always set up a piece of cloth and draw from it. It's one of the easiest ways of practicing skills without having a model and not resorting to photographs. So consider working on this a little bit more, trying to get a bit more value and contrast and range of value and a blend. It's too harsh. This line right here, too harsh. This isn't like a hard line. This is actually pretty soft. It takes just a little bit of smearing. You can go in there and smudge it with a smudge tool. It doesn't take much to just push that into a highlight or shadow and blend it so that it moves in space. It's pretty fun, actually. I love drawing drapery. It's one of my favorite things to do. So I'm a little bit strange, but we already knew that. So consider reworking or revising this a bit before the final presentation if you can. It would be great. If not, we'll keep it in mind for next time. Definitely get a little bit of blending and see even just the tiniest little bit of softening up those transitions will make this thing. I could sit here and do this all day, but you don't want to watch me sit here and do this all day. Anyway. Already looking a little bit more like fabric, don't you think? So, your other image is your cat. I did a little work on the cat's eye and tried to adjust some of the highlights and shadows roughly there. Not great, but the point of it being that this is your original drawing. A little more blending and paying attention to where the highlights and shadows actually, where the texture actually is most concentrated on your character here. there's little or no texture visible in the actual, on the actual fur. Here, texture disappears along in the white area and the highlight areas, and it disappears in the dark areas. And it mostly shows up on the edges where it's transitioning from either from the cap to the background or from the light areas to the dark areas. So blending that out and again squinting at your original and then squinting at your drawing, you should be able to see more clearly the larger, more significant areas of light and dark, and that will help improve the form and this the way the nose needs to be a lot bigger, actually. Poor kitty needs a bigger nose. So do pay attention to all of your significant. Sometimes it's hard for me to draw and talk at the same time, but you guys know that. Nose is up higher. See, that nose is halfway up in the space. It's actually more up here. If the eyes are up this high, the nose is up this high. So mind your proportions. This actually comes out really far here and comes down really far here. So I'd like to see that matched in your drawing. So light to the darker edge, light to the darker edge. Work texture towards the edge of the figure and not right on top of the, not across the whole thing simultaneously, because that will only end in tears. You know what I mean. All right. Finally, your last one here, your chiaroscuro. You've got pretty strong reference for your chiaroscuro, but the drawing itself is, where's the dark? If you squint at this drawing, we're not seeing the dramatic black all around the figure. So I went in and added that, something that you can easily do with your charcoal. Just go in and work up that black and then work out the transitional tones. These are not hard edges, these are soft blended edges. The hard edges happen when things overlap or when there's cast shadows. So I would love to see a bit more work done on this. You can work directly. You should be able to work directly on the actual drawing that you have. If you still have the reference, which I'm assuming that you do. And more toes out here. Double up her feet a little bit more. And really blend those edges so that the form turns in space. It's all about edges. It really is all, it's really all about edge control. If you don't have edge control, you're not going to make a good form. And again, squint at your reference and then at your drawing and see if it matches up. Okay. So our next one up is Brandon. So this doesn't look quite finished. I don't know if you're planning on finishing it. You didn't provide the reference for this figure. So I'm not sure exactly what you're using, but it looks like you're trying to use the poor man's chiaroscuro, which is great. So that means you need to pull out more of the whites and not have any outlines to speak of. So you don't have the reference of the figure in this selection, so I can't tell what you're using doesn't say that you used a live model. So, oh, the reference for the figure is in the line of action. Okay. So I need to, I could go look that up, but I'm going to assume. Assume always makes, you know, what it does, always causes problems, but. Try to pull out more highlight against the dark and blend those edges so that you are actually creating contrast between highlights and shadows. So even though you're using the darkening method, you can go back in with the charcoal, add more charcoal to parts of the drawing in order to bring out the contrast between the highlight and the shadows. So this isn't finished. I'm seeing that you want to get rid of this outline. You should be able to have the light come up right to the edge of the black and then carry on from there. So my recommendation is to finish this if you can. Try to bring in some more highlight and finish out the area, finish the drawing out because it's not complete. So I would think there would be some more light here. It's just not the same on a tablet as it is on paper. But I think that you kind of get my gist. I don't have the reference here, but I can go look it up. Give you some better feedback in the forums. The next one on here is your fabric, which you did provide reference for. Unfortunately, it doesn't look anything like that to me. You need a stronger light. It needs to be draped, not just folded. And if you're going to do folds, well, then let's have some perspective, you know. So it's like, get the perspective in here. This thing is actually shaped something more like that. You see the lines on your fabric. Put it into perspective. And then if you're going to do this flat piece of cloth, do something interesting, like cast the shadows on there and do the edges, and it should look like it's going even on places like here where the shadow is cast over various levels of the fabric. I would expect to see that in your drawing as well. So that is definitely, that needs a redo. Maybe that's real. It must be real fabric. I'm hoping that it is, but I would rather see it draped over something so you actually have some form, volume, mass, some interest. Now with your texture, again, when you look at the texture on any textured thing, you will see that it disappears in the highlights and becomes more intense in the transitional areas. So I'm not seeing any variation in the texture at all, and it really doesn't feel like it's got form. Even the claws themselves, that would be maybe so easy, really. Using charcoal, I recommend, because it's easier to manipulate, but this is a hard contrast. Nails are a nice hard contrast to the actual skin of this bird. It should have a highlight, should have shadow, it should have cast shadow. We've got a highlight here, we should have a highlight over here. It can be almost pure black underneath. Help me out here. Okay. even the shiny hard part of the claw is the texture that needs to be loved and has some attention paid to it. So increase that, smooth it out. You know, you should use a blending stick if you can and give it some real polish on those claws. Not too hard to do that. And with these guys here, it's really all about highlight, shadow, highlight, shadow, highlight, shadow. So we can do that by, especially if you're working on gray paper, it makes it really easy, but highlight, 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 highlight. And then you've got shadow, 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 shadow. And even this texture down here becomes really granular. It's not specific. So don't try to, I mean, you didn't put any real specifics, just the big circles. But I don't see the big circles down here. I'm seeing some kind of crunchy looking bits under down in here, and then it turns into these smooth scales, like armor scales. Which is all controlled by how much light and shadow you have on one side or the other. So I think you could definitely do a lot better. This really looks to me like it was a rush job and not something that you really examined to try to see how the textures actually come across. This here, I mean, this is straight lines. This is not straight lines. These are curved lines. This thing should be curved over and around the claw to make it actually round. And then there's an overlap here. And this is all kind of primary, and then you do the texture around that. So the texture disappears in here, becomes more vague, becomes stronger in areas of transition between edges and between highlights and shadows. And then you've got a third texture here, which is really cool, and it's this feathery stuff up on the feathers, basically. That could look really cool. Just get in there with some sponging tools and really examine how the textures are created and try to make them look more realistic. Okay. So that's Harry. Brandon. Evan doesn't get feedback because he's not putting it in a PDF, and it's a 20 megabyte PSD, which seems to be pretty consistent. Alan I'm not seeing where your reference for your figure is, but there may be more dark down here. This overall is pretty good, but I think that I don't have your reference, so I can't tell, but I think that the transitions are a little harsh. You can get a lot more out of it by squinting at your reference, squinting at your drawing. And this paper is really rough too. It's just one of those things. So you can have to get in there with a stump tool and try to do a little blending on the transitional tones here. It looks like she's got light coming from both sides too, which isn't great. It's better to have a single directional light. And when you have toned paper and you're working with light and dark, you should not need an outline around the figure. You can blend this out into just a value with some rub, some stump action, or some chamois, but you do not need an outline. This one, you've done it right here. This is good. This is exactly what we should be doing here, is just pure light against the tone of the background, or you can add in some shadow behind there, but not an outline. And the same as on this side. So it looks like this part of it is following the chiaroscuro conventions, just a little more blending in the core shadow and keeping that no outline. You've got ended up with an outline over here, so I would go back in with your eraser and your stump and get rid of that outline and accentuate the light against paper itself. It's easier to do this with a darker paper too. The light colored papers don't work as well. So I would like to see more blending, definitely more blending, and no outlines if possible. Try to blur out that outline so that it goes away. You've got the basic idea though, which is good. That I'd like to see more refinement in the execution. The next one is your drapery. So I think you said that your drapery got moved before you were able to take a picture of it. Okay, that's not a problem. I don't mind at all. You've got the essential idea, or maybe that was somebody else. At any rate, you did the drapery well. It's got the same kind of harsh transitions, just like Liliana had. You need to get in there with your smudging tool and your chamois and blend that with this right here. If you look at this highlight and shadow here, there's a core shadow, there's a cast shadow, there's stronger light on the fabric would be helpful. So you've started to do it. I remember that you said you were having some trouble with it. At this point, I think your main thing to do, if possible, is just to increase the blending. You know, go back in and really work it. Work those blends. Work the transitional tones. There's no outline here. There's no outlines around cloth. There's no outlines around objects at all. This should all just be play of value, light value, dark value, and all the range of gradients in between. So this becomes very soft. See how soft this is right here? This is super soft. It gets lighter. There's a lighter area right here. It's a little bit darker. Like I said, I can do this all day long. Something with the drapery is something I really like to do. But, ooh, not so much that. Let's use this here. We just want to slightly darken it here, here, here. It would just be like adding a little bit of charcoal back into your drawing. Try to get that core shadow. Try to get that cast shadow in here, and then it gets darker in here and darker in here and then darker still, and then here it gets really, really, really dark, and you don't seem to have the range of value that your still life has. Push that, pile on that charcoal and really push it into the paper, and then you can go back in and do some cool blending. It's almost like painting at this point. Very much like painting. So, blend, highlight, cast shadows, core shadows. Just squint at your still life and then squint at your drawing and see where you can improve the quality of the shadows versus, I see I'm a little lost here now. It's easy to get lost, but fortunately with drapery, no one's going to look at it and say, that does not look like that particular drapery. If it looks like drapery, it's going to be believed. Can already bring out some of the sense of that's a depression This is a highlight. This is a fold in here where it's a little darker because it turns away from the light a little bit. And this comes up higher. This is darker in here. This goes more like this. Drapery tends to make triangles out of stuff. It drops into its most typical form is in triangles. So you want to make sure that you get that triangle action in there. A little shadow here, shadow here, shadows here. So if you can work it, at least blend in the shadows, blend in your values a bit more on your drapery, and it'll start to look a lot more like fabric with some depth and some volume. So you see just the little bit that I've been playing around with it while talking has started to really push the, it's a little bigger in here, but can't try to get into that. Can't do it exactly like what you've got. It would take half an hour, and you don't want to watch me do this for half an hour. That would be boring. So try to get in there and do that yourself. I'd like to see revision on that, if possible, or at least in your final project, a better rendition. But if not, my fault, because I didn't get your feedback to you. Hopefully you can use this feedback for future. Actually, Photoshop's pretty fun to do drapery in because you can smush it around like charcoal without getting super dirty. So I happen to think getting dirty is a fine state of affairs while making art. So I think you can see, I hope you can see how it already is starting to form into highlights and shadows and peaks and valleys and dips and etc. I just like doing this. I don't want to stop. This is actually enjoyable. Wah! Okay. So, texture. Did we do the texture yet? Yes. This reference that you used for your bird does not look like a very good reference. It's pixelated and indistinct and looks like it's a highly processed photograph of possibly an x-ray even. So I would highly recommend looking for better quality reference unless you are really just using it for a jumping off point, an idea. Still would be a good idea to get in there with your chamois and remember that the textures disappear when they get in the highlights and get strong when they get in the shadows. Mind your edges. Edges are super important. Edges around everything. And on shiny surfaces, you have hard transitions, and on soft surfaces like feathers, you have soft transitions. So there's a lot not quite accurate in the structure of this bird, this bottom jaw in particular. And the eyeball. I don't know what your reference really should look like. It's not giving you a very clear and it seems really light brown. But it's easy to do eyeballs because they're a shiny, glassy, wet surface and are super fun to manipulate. I am a fan of shiny highlights. that. And on the beak as well, I would say take it dark. Darker, darker. Look at the squint at your surfaces, squint at your values, push the values to their almost exaggeration if you can, in order to get, and it's super black behind it. I'm not happy with your reference because it seems really processed. It's not a photograph of your reference. I mean, it's not a good photograph. It seems to be some kind of manipulated image. And that's fine. If you want to copy manipulated images, you'll get good at copying manipulated images. But if you want to learn how to make actual realistic 3D stuff, then use realistic 3D reference. Makes sense, doesn't it? The only way to be sure that you're getting it as close to life as possible. So, my recommendation on that. Now, next up is Graybill Helen. Helen's a little bit of a problematic because you didn't provide your references, and I'm not seeing this. I don't know if you toned your paper or if you're using white chalk. I can't tell. And we don't have your original reference, so I don't know what the background is like, but I think I recognize this figure. And like I mentioned to other students, highlights should eliminate the need for an outline, and you need to transition your tones so that there's a gradual range across form and the hard edges only where there is cast shadow. So, same with a fish. I don't see form, I don't see highlight. Want to see the variation in the texture as it is wraps around the surface of the object. And then the drapery here isn't making any sense at all. And since I don't have an image of your drapery, it's hard for me to help you decipher it. And you're casting a shadow on your photo. So that's something you should by now not be doing. This also looks like it's been shot at an angle, which is really not good for your work as far as displaying it. You want to always display it in its best light. Okay. Next one is Caleb. Oh, we always need more practice on our proportions. That's just a given. So I've got a version in Photoshop here. You were the one that said you did the drawing and then found your still life had been disrupted, or your fabric had been disrupted. That happens all the time. Just one of those trials of life happens to me all the time. So, going to your reference, you've got more gradation or gradual transitions than some. If you squint at it, I think you might find there's still a lot of hard transitional areas that could be softened. Just going in with a blending tool and softening up some of these transitions is going to make a huge difference in the quality of the form. So I know that your still life is not the same as your drawing because of interference, but nevertheless, even if I'm not using the reference, making these edges blend things, especially like here, we've got this like crinkly edge. That is always so cool to do, because you can make this like a deep crevice, and then this is a highlight. Let me try to lighten that up a little bit. Oh, this is why it's not working. I've got a need a hard edge. I always like to use a hard edge brush on those things so that they react better. So more highlight here, highlight on the upper edge, cast shadows, core shadows, more highlights. So you put a highlight on one side and a shadow on the other side, and you'll get a change of plane, which essentially makes form. So trying to make something up from your photo, even though it doesn't match. Sometimes I just like to put a little extra white on something and rub that in. So then you can see, if you put a highlight next to a shadow, you're going to get a peak and a valley, and then smudge that in. Just blend it. Can blend it, and it's going to make everything start to move in space. It's really like a magic trick. It's all just a trick of the eye. It's all fake, but we're trying to make it look as real as possible. So, okay, this is one folded piece here that's gotten too light, but we can fix that or darken that up a little bit. A little lighter. So we get a little highlight on this edge here. You can use the eraser to pull it out or add chalk, white chalk to it, though it's hard to put white chalk over black. I don't recommend it necessarily because it can muddy it up. But even accentuating and blend, keep the blend happening, and you get a hard edge on a cast shadow, like so. Let's say this is a cast shadow too. I'm just gonna put one in there. Here's a good cast shadow here. It follows along the contour, so this would be somewhat of a cast shadow, and then this overlaps here, accentuate that cast, like so. And it's crispy. You do have some hard transitions which make the fabric look like it's pressed, you know? So that's a good thing, but this cast shadow will follow along the surface of the curves of the of what's underneath it, which makes it even more realistic. Whenever you can get a cast shadow to follow the curves of the surface underneath it, then you get something really cool. So, kind of sort of making this up, but the shadow comes down here, and then it comes up, and then it goes around. You might have a little bit of a more shadow in here. I think, I'm pretty sure, that if you take a look at how it is and how it was, that you'll be able to see how the manipulating the blend is going to increase the realism and the depth in your drapery. Understanding how the drapery works will help you when you want to make up your drapery to do something that's completely from your imagination. That's what everybody wants, right? To draw from imagination. Personally, I like to draw from real stuff because I like to look at it. I like to see it. And try to imitate what I see. But if I have to, I know how something is supposed to look, so I can manipulate that too, which works out pretty well. shadow here, which doesn't really match up overall, but it's more of an, becomes an almost an impression when you take a lot of liberties with. This here should be dark behind the back, behind this, so that the light of the fabric stands out on top and the shadow is behind it. So we can do dark in the background, and that allows the structure to jump forward. We're pushing and pulling on the angles and the forms in order to blah, blah, blah. Yeah, all that stuff. Curve right here. So hopefully that is helpful. Fabric likes to make triangular forms, especially when the cloth is fairly crisp. It breaks into smoother, softer triangles when it's a flowing fabric. But here, it's dark in there. And then you can just keep pushing and pulling the shadows and the highlights in order to develop this. But pick and choose where you have hard shadows where the light is cast, soft shadows where the light wraps around the object. That's what you've got right there. And this wraps and then comes up and then flows. Things get a little darker as you get closer to the lighter areas, and a little lighter as you get closer to the darker areas. So use that to really push and pull on your fabric to make it come out, come forward, recede, some manipulation of those edges. This becomes, breaks up into too much of a pattern. It's hard to see what you're actually looking at form-wise. So, and with that hard outline on the outside, you need to blend that out more to make that out in the background there. Okay. Hard to do this on this, but this is another great place where we get the almost like a little bit like landscape, which is really kind of cool. You can do kind of an imitation landscape just with your lights and darks of fabric. I don't know. Lots of kids like to play toy soldier on their bed and make their landscape out of their bedclothes, and there's a reason for that. The drapery is sort of like the land. So consider these alterations and changes. Hopefully you can make some changes to what you've got, or at least get in there and try it again on your own. That's the saddest thing, is when you don't try something before the class is over and then you never really revisit it, so you forget what it is that was so cool that you should have tried. So, all right, stop playing with that. Let's see. What do we have next? Anthony. Anthony, I demonstrated how to do the chiaroscuro without gray paper several times. So I will add the link again to the demonstration. Might want to try this again. Also, you did not provide samples of what you were working from. So I do not see your references, but I'm not seeing strong light and dark on this figure, and I'm seeing a lot of contours and struggling with proportions still. Texture is rudimentary at best, and I'm assuming this is a piece of fabric, probably a towel, but doesn't have a lot of form or highlights or shadows or structure. So I know you've been struggling through this class. I have yet to see a true improvement. This is getting a little bit better, but it's slow going, so you're going to have to keep up with your practice. This one here, after Anthony, we've got Guillermo. Beautiful piece of drapery. Really nice. You could still get in there and push on those transitional tones to make them blend just a little bit more. Bring out some white on the highlights, but you're getting some good range of value and starting to push away the outlines, which is great. So that's a really nice reference cloth too. It has good highlights and good shadows on it. The turtle's pretty cool. The only thing I think that your file was a little bit large in here. It came out to be like 3,000 pixels when I moved it. Might want to try, you know, do the levels to bring up the contrast a little. It's always a good thing to do when it tends to be a little dark. And then, in addition, take a look at the shadows on the figure. So you've got a bit of the idea where some of it disappears, but look where it really accentuates too. So I definitely think you could add some stronger shadows here, along here, in here, in his mouth, under his neck, definitely under the shell. This is a great deal of cast shadow going on here. So even though it's focusing on the texture, you want to push those shadows too. He's been cut out of his background and is leaving a fake drop shadow on everything, which is kind of a drag. But just adding in like a partial tone on the end of his nose, back of his leg, underside of the shell here, can really get some drama going. I just go in and blend it. Or you can do a light layered overlay. Since this is pencil, it's easier to just work your texture instead of trying to blend it too much with a stump. You don't really need to do that with this. You can do like layers of pencil. And then you can see where the lights and the shadows on the textures themselves start to really pop. Getting the inside of that mouth dark will make a huge difference in the sense of insideness of his mouth. And more shadows in here, definitely. So even just that little bit of shadow brings more form and life and volume to your structure. Textures look pretty good. Remember, yeah, you're doing it here. You got the idea of dropping out detail of the texture in the highlights and in the shadows. But go ahead and put in those extra shadows too. I think is a really cool drawing. Good one, really good one for your portfolio, because the drawing itself is pretty exquisite. I think that you can take it a little further, a bit more push on the shadow, on the shadows. And that would be what I would do. Those are pretty cool. Tortoises. This is actually a tortoise. So I would get in there with some more shadow work, make that thing pop. All right. Now we're down to Bonnie. Got kind of a strangely textured cloth without a lot of form or draping. It would be nice if it had a bit more, if it had been draped over the chair instead of just like flopped. But done a decent job on the texture. It's a bit of an excess of line that could be eliminated through more blending or manipulating of the lightness and darkness of your pencil. But your figure here kind of confuses me because she seems to be strangely posed. She should have a bit of a chiaroscuro sort of thing going on here. I'm confused as to why this goes up at such an angle here and doesn't here. And these arms seem to be the same length, although the shoulder is up high. The shoulder's going to be up high, and this one's going to be low. I would think this hand would be down here, and this hand would be up here. But aside from that, I don't have your original reference of your photo. It's you've got a YouTube link that I'm not going to go look up right now. But remember, the chiaroscuro part is actually on the figure itself. So we want to see light and shadow and form on the figure, not just outlines and contours. The other specimen textures, more blending or more quality in laying down of the line work. It's pretty flat. And that is that.